Am I on good now? Yeah, I can hear myself now. Hey, everyone, how are you today? Hey, things are a little different in case you couldn't tell. I'm already up here. We have only done three songs. We've got a fun, full, packed morning. We're going to have some baptisms here in a few minutes, but before I get too further along, I'm going to ask Aubrey to come up. She has an announcement that she wants to give, and then I'm going to jump into the rest of it. Go for it, Miss Aubrey. It should be.
So this coming Saturday is Touch a Truck, Touch a Life, where we're raising money to conquer childhood cancer. So if you would love to come and help out, raise some funds with us, we have lots of different options. We would love your help to set up on Friday right after school around 3 until we have all our supplies together. And Saturday morning, if you want to be here bright and early around 8:30, I will be here and we'll be bringing all those big trucks in. And if you want to help to clean up trash, we've got lots of different things for you to do. In the back is a yellow sign-up sheet, and I would love to have your information if you'd love to be a part of it. Thank you.
Thanks. All right. Thank you. You take it. Don't hurt anybody with it, okay? So, yes, be part of that. We have a few things that we're going to go over. I'd like to pray with you and then go from there. So, Lord, we just thank you for this morning. I praise you for everyone who was able to make it here today, and pray for those who weren't able to come at all, whether they're sick, traveling, whatever, God. You know all, and you are above it and beyond it all. So, Lord, would you minister to each and every one of us? Father, especially myself today, would you empty me of any problems, any thoughts that don't go along with your message today? Anything that I shouldn't say, remove it. And put everything that you want in my heart and in my mind. And so, Lord, as we focus on you this morning, and as we think about who you are and how incredible it is that you, as the creator of everything, who have always been, cares about us. You sent your son Jesus for us to die on a cross, and you raised him from the dead 3 days later so that we could be reunited with you. And so, Lord, as we celebrate that this morning, as we celebrate baptisms, may the praise only go to you, because we didn't do anything. You've done it all. And so, as we get to receive this offer, as we get to give this offering and give it to you, God, I pray, Lord, that you would use it. I pray that it would be used exactly how you want it. And Lord, if there's something that we're not doing that you don't want, would you make it very obvious? And Father, would you bless the givers as they give? And Lord, this morning I just need an extra special touch as I preach your word. Lord, I pray and thank you for the service. And I thank you that you've been there part of it. And I pray that you continue to be through the rest of this whole service. And as I prayed already, empty our hearts so they can be ready to be filled with you, God, with what you have. For it's just Jesus' precious and holy and healing name I pray, and everyone says. As we take the offering up, Misty, could you pull up that video from yesterday and show that? Do you have it? Jared said you might have it. If you don't, it's okay. We can do it later. I can't see your head. I'm going to move on from it right now because we're going to have a baptism in just a second. But I'm kind of stalling because, as you know, Jared was just standing right here and had to have time to run up the stairs and go up there and get ready. So I'm trying to give him a few moments to be ready for that. But baptisms are one of those things that, well, if you've done it, you understand what it feels like. And you understand that it's a huge marker in your Christian life. It doesn't save you, but boy, does it do something to you. And so as we prepare to see these offerings, I'm going to go ahead and have everybody greet each other, and maybe they'll have time to get the video on while we're greeting each other. So I'm going to have you guys stand up, seriously, stand up right where you are, Touch your toes. And say hi to each other for a couple of minutes. Go for it.
In the morning when my heart is cold, you're the heat for my weary soul. You're the good in all I know. In the mirror, all that I see is your grace looking back at me. I'm not the man that I used to be. Everything comes alive. Everything comes alive. Everything comes alive. Everything comes alive.
How are you?
I am
you. It's okay. You've never really met me, so I understand. I got a hope that I'm sure of. I'll be with you in heavenly places. I'll be with you in heavenly places. I'll be with you in heavenly places. Heavenly places. My heart is beating to the of your love. My feet are running ever faster to your grace. My heart is beating to the rhythm of your love. My feet are running ever faster to your
everything
grace.
Comes alive. I'll be with you in heavenly places.
Everything comes alive.
I'll be with you in heavenly places.
Everything comes alive.
I'll be with you in heavenly places. Hello, hello. Okay, if you don't mind, find your seats, find your seats. It's a little bit different of a day, I get it. You guys are used to us starting out with worship and having you come back. But if I can get you to find your seats fairly quickly, that'd be great. So, as you guys are sitting down, as you're finding your places, and I know you love to say hello to each other. Believe me, I would have loved to have said hello to each and every one of you myself, but I didn't have time. So I'm giving you a couple more minutes for everybody to say hello and finish their talking, and then I'm going to start. We have to have a baptism, so let's get going. That means please. Should I start counting like they do in Awana? The one, two, three? Okay, so I just want to say one quick thing about baptism real fast. Baptism is one of those things that either trips you up or not. It's one of those things that, for some reason, It's the scariest thing after you get saved that you have to do. And it's one of those things that so many people are afraid to do. They don't like the idea of either. Some people have been afraid of going under the water. Some people have been afraid of looking at all of you. And believe me, I understand that because I'm looking at you right now and you're scary. But some people just realize it's time. And so there's a couple of people up here that have been waiting and decided it's time. So without further ado, it's all up to you.
All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the waters of baptism. We're excited this morning to get to have a couple of individuals who have made the decision to follow Jesus for the rest of their life, and they're going to go in public this morning and letting you guys all know about that. So we're really excited. And we all know that those of us that have been saved, those of us that have given our life to the Lord, we know that it was by grace. We know that it was an act of God, that God moved in our hearts and that he helped us see how much he loved us. He helped us realize that we need a Savior and that he is the way, he is the truth, he is the life. And so I'm going to call up our first participant this morning, and she's a young lady who's in our junior high youth group right now, and I met with her in my office and got to talk to her about her faith, and one of her friends was in the room too. And so another side of baptism is not only does she get to go public, but you get to witness this decision, and it's a big deal. To give your life to the Lord is a huge deal. It's a life-changing decision. It's bigger than marriage. And I think of marriage, and I go, man, marriage is the manliest decision that a guy can do because he gives his life to one lady for the rest of his life. And in a sense, because God has given us marriage to point to our relationship with him, we are, in a sense, saying, I do to the Lord. We're saying, I will follow you for the rest of my life. You are my God and no one else. There's no other God but you. And only you deserve my life because you gave it to me to save me. So without further ado, I'm going to call down Sage Sexton. And I'm going to ask Sage a couple of questions this morning, and I already know the answer, but Sage, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. And here's another big one. Is it your desire to follow him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
All right. Then upon your public declaration of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, I'll now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. All right, we're not done. We got one more. The next young man I'm going to call up, I just met him this morning, but Eugene knows personally a couple of individuals in our church here, and his sister goes to our FCA club, and what I've heard from Eugene from speaking with him personally, and also with speaking with Pastor Bruce and David Carmona, who he knows, this is a serious thing. It's not... Giving your life to the Lord isn't something you do without even thinking about it. This is, you're literally giving your life to someone, to a person, to your Creator. And so he had some questions about baptism. What does baptism mean? Do I have to be baptized to be saved? What's the symbolism behind baptism? We got to answer all those questions for him. And after that, after hearing that, he said, yeah, I need to be obedient. I need to be baptized. And so Eugene is here this morning, and so let me call down Eugene Mays. Yep, come on over here. All right, so I'm going to ask Eugene the same questions that I asked Sage. Eugene, have you accepted Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior?
Yeah.
All right. Bigger question. Bigger question. Are you going to follow him for the rest of your life?
Yeah.
All right. Amen. Okay. Then upon your public declaration of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. It's hard to make all you guys see us. I now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with him in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. All right. That's it.
All right.
Thank you, guys.
You know, that is such a crazy, humbling time. Do any of you remember the time you were baptized? I do. I remember it very well. And it's just one of those things. I just want to share just real quick about Eugene. He's been coming for a while, off and on. And he's been good friends with Paul. He's been hanging out with Paul and stuff. But the other day, he had some things he had to wrestle with. And the one thing that I want to make very, very clear to everybody who's baptized is baptism doesn't save you. Okay? When you go in that water, the salvation part's already taken care of. You've already accepted Christ. That water, there's no magical powers in it. There's nothing that transforms you and washes it all away because Jesus' blood does that, amen? But there is an importance to it. You see, because he was asking me, nobody's ever said this to me before. He said, well, if it doesn't save me, I don't really want to do it then. What's the point? Because if I die and I still go to heaven and I'm already saved, then why? I said, yeah, man, that's a good question, because why? It comes back to one single thing. Well, it's a bit more complicated than that, but it's because Jesus said to. It's the first thing he asks us to do after we accept Christ. If you read the New Testament, you read the Bible, every single time someone was saved, they were baptized immediately. Matter of fact, it was so soon that's why people get it so confused that it's part of the salvation experience. That's part of salvation itself because it's like so quick after. And I don't know when we started making people wait. I don't know, you know, at what point in church times or whatever that we didn't always have the tanks full. And we said, okay, well, let's schedule this for next week at this time and whatever else. But we were talking, and when I told him, I said, you know, it's the one thing that Jesus commanded us to do that and communion, which is what we're going to celebrate here in a few minutes. And he said, if we can't even do the first thing he asks us, how can we expect to live our life blessed by God? Because you guys tell me this. I guess this sounds like a trick question. If somebody tells us to do something and we don't do it, what's that called? It's disobedience. When I said that, like just like that to him, he went, I have to do that. I have to do this. I mean, I have to. And so maybe out there, there's some people thinking to yourselves, well, I haven't done it. I don't want to do it. I'm scared of it. It doesn't make any sense. It does make sense. It's what God, it's the first thing we're supposed to do after we get saved. That's all free. That's not part of my message. It's just something I wanted to share with you. But it does tie in, because we have baptism, right? We have that part that's tied to everything that we are. And it's a perfect picture of what's already happened in our life. You see, the Bible says that before we accept Christ, we're dead in our trespasses and sins. We're dead to God. We're spiritually dead. And so essentially we're walking zombies, so to speak. We're dead people walking around. But the minute we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, we're saved. That means that we accept him and we become alive to God. And that's what that pictures, before and after. And I want you to know that those two that you just saw and many others, they wanted you to see something in their life, because I told you this before, and I'll say it again. Salvation is not a private thing. It's a very public event. And people are supposed to know about it. It goes back to where Jesus says you can't hide it under... You don't take a candle or a lantern and hide it. And so, one way or the other, if you haven't gotten that part right, if you haven't started that yet, if that part of your journey hasn't happened, maybe it's time. Because the very next thing we're going to talk about today, the thing I was going to do a whole entire message on communion today, and I'm going to go through it fairly, not super quick, super simple, at least it is to me. But if someone was to walk up to you and ask you, what is communion, what is the Lord's Supper, could you tell them what it is? I mean, other than, yeah, we come and we sit in front of each other and we eat this bread and we drink this juice. Can you accurately talk? Can you say why we do it? Or is it just one of those things that you just always done because we do? And my biggest fear, I don't know if it's a fear, that might not be the right wording, but one of my thoughts all the time is when we do communion, because we do it once a month. We do it every month. The first Sunday of every month we have communion here at Chapel Grace. I don't know when they started that. I think it's been from the very beginning of the conception of Chapel Grace, when it started a long time ago. A lot of other churches do it as well, but they do it on a four times a year, what's that called, quarterly basis. And they make it this huge thing, and they don't do it on Sunday morning, they do it at Sunday night, and they make it this big service, and it's very intense. I just don't want communion to become this thing that we do. Does that make sense to you? I don't want this. Okay, it's the first Sunday of the month. Okay, let's get ready. I get to have my juice and my bread. This is way more than that. This isn't just something that we just do. Baptism isn't just something that we just do. It's extremely significant in our life. Baptism is a one-time thing. After you accept Christ, you're baptized. It's called a believer's baptism. If you're not saved, if you haven't accepted Christ, meaning if you're not a believer in Jesus, why would you be baptized? What does it represent if you don't believe in Jesus, if you haven't accepted him? Because it doesn't do anything more than show everyone what's happened. I'm not making light of it. Of course I'm not. It's extremely important. And I was baptized. As a matter of fact, I've taken it so important that when I first accepted Christ, and they told me in the Baptist church, go get baptized, blah, 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 you know. So I went and got baptized, and it felt great, and everybody cheered for me. But I struggled for a long time in my faith about whether I did it right or whether I had really accepted Christ at that moment. And when I went to Bible college, I asked Kelly, I wrestled with this, and I finally went and talked to a pastor out there, and our pastor of that church. Help me remember his name. I can see he was a really tall, skinny guy. I know it right there, but my brain just went south. But I asked him, explained to him my situation. I said, I accepted Christ, or thought I did, but really I think it was this point in my life when I truly accepted Christ. This is when I changed. I mean, and we talked. And so I got baptized again. Because I felt like the first one was just, I got all wet, and that was it. So I took it pretty serious. So it's a big deal. And then we have communion, the Lord's Supper. And these are the two things that Jesus said, do these two things. Be baptized. And in 1 Corinthians, we see where Paul describes it out. But Jesus explained it before he was crucified. The night that he was going to be taken and arrested, they had communion together. He and his apostles. The apostles, the 12 men that followed him closely. And even the one who was going to betray him was there. And Jesus explained to them, he said, it's pretty plain that this body represents the bread represented his body and the wine represented his blood. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. I think it even, does it say it on the front there? Do in remembrance. Yeah, this do in remembrance of me. It's a memorial. It's to remind us continually of what it took. So it's February. I love series. So this isn't going to be that kind of series, but we're going to be talking about the love of God all month. And the first one is God's love in communion. Because if you don't see the love of God through this, I'm not sure that you're ever going to see it. Because this is his demonstration. The Bible says that there's no greater thing than a man lay down his life for his friend or for another. So, what's the meaning of Lord's Supper? God's love and communion. So, open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians, chapter 11, 23 to 33. This is where Paul goes through and institutes it, I guess, or so to speak, kind of shares with us how we should do it. Now, while you're flipping there, let me explain to you that those people, I need my water, those people that were doing in the church in Corinth, they weren't doing things very good. They were messing things up. And communion was one of them. The Lord's Supper was one of them. He really starts discussing it in verse 17, but he just goes through, he says, there's divisions among you. But on verse 20, he says, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat. See, they were coming together saying it was the Lord's Supper, but he's telling them, when you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper that you're eating. He said, because for as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anybody else. You just rush into it, first of all. And he says, without waiting for anyone else, one remains hungry, another gets drunk. He says, don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not. So Paul's really getting on him about you're coming together and saying it's the Lord's Supper, but not everybody's getting any of it, some of it. And so, none of you are waiting for it. It's not going in turn. And you're getting drunk? That's bad. So he says this, for I received from the Lord, verse 23, what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. And that means they died. They're not sleeping, you guys. They're not undercover sleeping in. They're dead. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. He says, if anyone's hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it may not be result in judgment. And when I come to you, I will give you further instructions. The Lord's Supper. Communion. Very important. You find God's love all throughout it. It's an expression of God's love. The first thing we see is that it's an expression of God's love to us. Verse 24, look at it right there. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." It's about him. It's about what he did. It's about his body. By the way, in case you hadn't figured it out, this is for Christians. This is for those who've accepted Christ, because you're remembering what Christ has done. It's an expression. You realize and you see the love of God through the sacrificial death of Jesus. You notice the resurrection isn't mentioned here, because that's celebrated later also, but this is, it comes into it. But we're called to remember all that Jesus did. The love, the expression of love from God. Can I ask you a question? Do you ever forget that Jesus is God? Does it ever confuse you? Like when we talk about Jesus and God, we talk about them like they're two separate people. But the Bible is very clear that Jesus is God. In John 1:1 and many other places, it talks about he is the Word. And he existed always. He was here at creation. So if you want to talk about the love of God, from John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." He sent his Son Jesus, but he sent himself in skin as a person to die. To die. Because he knew he had to. Because sin is that horrific. And that I don't even know if I've got a good enough word, that God can't have anything to do with it. It is disobedience. It started with disobedience. Someday I really want to talk to Adam and Eve and say, "Why did you eat from that stinking tree?" You know, I don't look at the Bible as a bunch of fiction stories. And I don't pretend to be perfect, because I'm certainly not. But everything in this is true. And when you read from the very beginning and you see that there were two people that began everything. God created Adam, and from Adam came Eve. And everything started from there. And when you realize that not only did we begin there, it's also where sin entered the world. When Adam and Eve decided to eat from the tree, not just touch it, right, David, but eat from it. And then God said right away, he had a fix for it. He already knew what to do. See, because God has always required something to be done. You look back in the Old Testament, you look back in the beginnings, and God had already told Adam and Eve, some point, we don't ever see it, but obviously they knew they were already supposed to sacrifice. Because after they sinned, the next story that we hear is about Cain and Abel, their kids. And they're offering sacrifice to God. And Cain, you guys know the story? You guys know this thing from the Bible? And Cain brought the best, the very best that he could. He was a farmer, and he brought the best veggies. Jared, I bet you it was like a steak, you know, like tomato. I don't like tomatoes, but, you know, probably a big old huge steak tomato, you know, that was just juicy and whatever. And he probably brought the best stuff that he had, and he offered it to God. And then his brother Abel brought a lamb, slaughtered it, and offered it to God. And God had favor on Abel's, because Abel did what God asked. We don't know when God told them, but we know that he told them because they were doing it. And God said to, and Cain got mad because God had favor on Abel's sacrifice, and he accepted it. And God said to Cain, "What's wrong with you? Just do what I've asked and everything will be fine." Right? And then we know it got worse. He rose up and killed his brother Abel. And he was banned. You see, sin's been part of our life from the very beginning. And this expression of God's love, this, what we do today, is a result of our sin. This celebration or remembrance, I don't know if you want to call it a celebration or remembrance, this thing, this here, is an expression of God's love. He broke his body. I won't put this back. Some of you guys might have a problem with that, especially since I've been wiping my sweat all over it. This isn't Jesus' body, okay? It doesn't become his body. It will never contain his body. It has nothing. It's not him. It's just a representation of his body. It's something physical for us to hold in our hand to remember and understand the expression of God's love towards us. And as we hold this in our hand this morning, we're supposed to remember his body that was broken for us. But if you've not accepted Christ, that wouldn't make a lot of sense to you, would it? This is an expression of his love to us. His body broken so that we could be reunited with him. God demanded perfection. God demands perfection, I should say, in righteousness and holiness. And that's why when sin entered, God couldn't be around Adam and Eve anymore, and he had to tell them to go. He still took care of them, by the way. He didn't leave them. He didn't say, "I hate you and I'm gone." He's not an absent father, none of that stuff. He still provided, but it was different. See, Adam and Eve got to walk with God. That's what the Bible says. It says that God walked with them every day. He walked and talked with them. I don't know how long that was. I don't know what the time difference between when he created them and sin came. I have no idea. I have no idea how long God got to hang out. I mean, they got to talk physically with God every day. But one day it stopped because of their sin, which we inherited. And then we also have the cup, which represents his blood. Because when his body was broken, his blood was spilled. And these two things are an expression of God's love towards us. It's what we remember. It's what we're supposed to remember. In case you forgot. So it's an expression of God's love. That's the first part of this. It's also his love towards us and our love back to him. We love you and remember what you did for us. I get ahead of myself all the time. It's also an explanation of his love. We do communion. We do it to proclaim and show his intense love for us. That's why we do it. The word proclaim, in the King James, it says show, which literally means to explain. It's an explanation of God's love for us. This explains it. We had to have it. It had to happen. It's also an expectation that goes along with it. So there's God's expression of love towards us, God's explanation which is, it had to happen. He says, do this in remembrance of me. As oft as you take this, remember my body was broken and my blood was spilled for you. It's also, there's an expectation that goes along with it. An expectation of his loving return. Remember what I told you just a few minutes ago? God didn't leave us for good. When he had to separate himself from the sin, he didn't just up and walk away. We have an expectation because Jesus told us that he was going to come back. So we also can look to that expectation. And maybe another word would be anticipation of his return. Woke up this morning like all of you guys did to the news of that horrible train wreck in South Carolina. The other day, we had a scare in our own town where, whether or not, whatever, but there was a possibility of a shooter at our schools, and the schools went on lockdown. You know, and all that stuff. You know, thankfully, I don't think anybody was hurt, right? But it was still scary for the moment. And if any of you remember that, I'm like, oh my gosh, my wife's there. Oh my gosh, Kyle is right there at the middle school because they said, whatever. But wasn't it just recently, how many school shootings are we hearing about? How much stuff are we hearing about every day? Is anyone tired of it? Seriously, am I the only one? Are you ready for it to end? Is anybody else ready for it to end? You know, there's an expectation that it's all going to end that way. All this horrible stuff. It's going to stop. God is going to call us. He's going to come back for us. Or some of us might not have to wait that long and we get to go on ahead of everybody else and we have a great reunion someday. But it's an expectation of his loving return. And one day, we will no longer have to endure the world's troubles. Yeah, praise God. That's right. One day, it'll be over. But today isn't that day, right? So we have this. Because it's an expression of God's love for us. There's kids in here, there's little kids, so I'm not going to go too graphic. You guys probably already heard me go very graphic in the details about Jesus' death on the cross. And if you want to know more about it, just do some research. But it was pretty brutal. And I just say that it explains and displays the true ugliness of sin. It's also an examination. We are to take an internal look into our lives. Before we take this, before we do this, which we're going to in about a couple of minutes. So I'm going to get the guys, you might have to move. I'm going to ask whoever it is that's doing communion, if you guys can come right up here as I get ready to finish this last little bit. It's an examination into our lives. You guys can just sit. You might want to sit down maybe a few more minutes. So you're doing it all by yourself. You're going to start passing them out. We'll get them. Okay, it's an examination. Verse 28. We're to take an internal look into what's going on in our lives. You remember in the beginning of this passage, Paul said that some of them were taking it in an unworthy manner. Right? Meaning that they weren't doing it right. They were getting drunk. Sounds to me like they just turned it into a regular dinner and a big party and put the name, the Lord's Supper on it. I'm taking the next bid, next highest bid for the next person up here. But we're supposed to take an internal look into who we are. First of all, how much do we love him? That's not for me to judge. Because this isn't about judgment. This is about self-examination. This is about you looking into you. because nobody knows you better than you. Amen? So it's not up to me to judge you, because I'm not going to, and I never will. Lord knows I have enough to worry about in my own life. I don't need to worry about what you did yesterday, what you ate for lunch yesterday, or whatever else. I don't care about all that. And that's not what this is about. Because how much we love him. Oops. I think there. Shows how much we love others. Because that love of God is going to flow out to others. And there's another portion of the Bible that I forgot to look it up, where it says that before you bring the gift to the altar, if you have aught with a brother or sister, it means if you have a problem, if you have something going on, make it right first. So leave the gift there, go make it right, and then come back and offer. It's the same principle here. So before we take communion, before Jared and I give these things to these awesome men right here, and they carry the elements out to you, we all need to take an internal look into at ourselves before we do this. So I want to give you opportunity to pause for a few moments right where you are and just talk to God. Right? Do an internal investigation of yourself. I want to make this very clear that this is something that we do as Christians, as believers, as followers of Jesus, because we do this in remembrance of what he did for us. So if we have a problem or an issue, some things we can't fix, boom. But the one thing you can do is ask for forgiveness from God today, right now, this moment. And then ask for God for forgiveness. If you need to forgive someone else, whether you did it, whether you're right or wrong, that's not the point. Just make it right. So I'm going to give you a few moments right there. I'm going to even open it up to up here. If you want to come up here and pray, because I'm going to sit down on my knees for a minute. I'm going to pray and talk to God myself. So for about 2 minutes, just talk to God. Do an internal investigation, an internal look at yourself. Don't worry about your neighbor. Don't worry about whether I'm wearing dress shoes or not. Don't worry about what someone else is wearing. Don't worry about what someone else is thinking, saying, or doing. Worry about you. It's not your job to judge everyone else. It's your job to judge you. So for the next couple of minutes, judge you. Go. Your Father in heaven, I just want to thank you, God, for giving us the opportunity to serve you, to worship you. But first and foremost, God, thank you for dying on the cross. thank you for all that you did on my behalf. You took the punishment for me in the form of Jesus. You took my punishment. You took my judgment and you put it on yourself. You subjected yourself to your creation so that we would have a way to be with you again. So thank you, God, for that. And thank you that you give us opportunity to look at our lives and internally investigate ourselves. Father, may we always do that first before we pass judgment on other people. May we not pass judgment on other people, because that's not our job. May we seek you, God. And may we seek a way to teach people about you and to show people about you. God, may we always be worried about one thing, whether or not this person or that knows your son Jesus. May the love that you showed to us be evident in our lives so we can show it to others. As we get ready to celebrate, not just celebrate, as we get ready to remember what you did for us, God, may we be humbled and may we be willing to serve you with open hearts and ready to do whatever you ask us to do. Whatever it is. Which Jesus' precious and holy and healing name I pray and we all say. So as we get ready to take the offering, I mean, not the offering, communion, the Lord's Supper, we pass these out. So the first part of it is always the bread. I'm just going to take them off now, Jared. Is that all right? I know it's a little bit out of the ordinary. And so as we get ready to pass these out, I do it first, right? I'm getting all confused with myself. As we get ready to pass these out, and as you receive this element, we call it an element, it's bread. Hey, guys, if you understand, I'm going to actually ask Mike to pray for it as I hold this. I'll give it to you, and you can pray with it in your hand, can't you?
Yeah.
Okay. Doing things a little different today, switching it up, even confusing myself because I'm going out of the norm. Mike, would you pray for the bread?
Sure. Heavenly Father, we praise you so much, God, for sending Jesus to die in our place, to suffer the punishment for our sins, mm-hmm. and, you know, to go and be there with you to intercede for us and prepare a place for us to come. It's so awesome. And Lord, we remember you, Jesus, and we celebrate you now. Thank you so much. Amen.
As you guys can go ahead and start. As the men distribute the bread, as you receive this, I'm going to come over and steal my pieces, all right? Take a moment when you get it. As you can tell, I tried to do things a little differently because I really wanted to think about this today. I don't know if I was clear in my communication skills about everything, but the one thing I do think we need to remember is this represents his body broken for us. So when you receive it, would you hold it? Maybe look at it? Give out a prayer right there in your spot. And just thanking him.
just thinking about the baptisms today and how cool they were and the picture that they displayed about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection and what it meant. It's just perfect that we had it started with the baptism, we're ending with communion, and it's all centered around Jesus. And just thinking about Eugene, actually now he's doing the communion. He's passing out the elements. That's crazy. But the one thing he said is once he realized that he had to do that, to be obedient, it was like a light bulb. And he was like, I don't even have to think about it anymore. I wonder how many times in our lives that we kind of overthink things. Right? We overthink salvation so much. We make it way more complicated than it needs to be. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's really that simple. Thank you, sir. He took it, and he said, take in remembrance of me, take and eat. So take and eat.
So we're going to talk about the blood now. Just quickly want to just share with you guys, man, life is hard. And I deal with my succumbing to my fears and the pressures of, a bunch of other things. And I think we're probably our worst critic. Like we talked about kind of examining our own hearts, like, man, I'm a failure. Lord, before you, I'm a failure. But our hope, which is found in the truth of Scripture, is that that his blood is greater than our sin, that his love is greater than our sin. I just, since I've been singing, up here, I think of there's a lot of different bridges and choruses that have these one-liners. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And we just sang this morning, my sin is great, but your love is greater. And it's just those reminders that and that's what we got to cling. That's what our hope has to be. It's not like I'm so lost that I can't be found, or I'm such a sinner that I can't be forgiven, because Jesus says that we are forgiven and it's once and for all forgiven. It's not he has to continually go to the cross on our behalf and shed his blood again. It's once and for all, it's done. And so we struggle, I think, with our emotions, our anxieties, our failing over and over again, that, man, is it enough? We find ourselves questioning the sufficiency of Jesus' sacrifice. And so today we claim that, yes, Jesus' blood was enough. His death on the cross was enough, and it's once and for all. So that's what we're going to have David pray about this morning, and that's what we're taking. That's that truth. This is a cup of truth, a little morsel of truth, right, that we're remembering, and that's that Jesus' blood was enough.
Well, dear Heavenly Father, God, we just humble ourselves before you again, Lord God, just to remember everything that the price that was paid for the sacrifice for our sin, everything that our failures, our choices that we've made. But you made the choice to lay your life down for us, to take the punishment we deserved, to pay the price of the ultimate sacrifice, is to have your blood poured out so we could be forgiven. And so we're so thankful for everything that you did, the price that you paid. And we just want to honor you, Lord, today. And, Lord, your work by the power of your Spirit in our conscience, and to know that you've forgotten all of our sins as far as the east is from the west. You've removed them as far, and you've even forgotten all those things that have taken place because of what you did. And so we're so grateful, thankful that we didn't deserve it, but Lord, you loved us to offer that to us, your unending, loving grace, amazing grace. And so, Lord, we just thank you. Pray your blessing over this cup as we remember your sacrifice. And we just give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Pray. Amen.
All right, so as we take, we're saying, Lord Jesus, before you, before everyone, I believe that your sacrifice was enough. I believe. And so, in Corinthians, it says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So let's remember, let's claim, yes, Lord, I believe that your blood was enough.
The praise team has one song that they want to end with.
And as they get ready to do that, thanks, guys, for serving. I appreciate that. You can just leave it right where you are. I'll take it from there. Yeah. As they're getting set for the second month in a row, I neglected to talk about this. There's a lot going on when we get ready to start service, and on my heart, it's always there, and then I get up there and I forget. In case you were wondering what this is, you look on, it says communion offering. This is above and beyond our normal tithes and offerings. This is something that we take every month, and whatever comes in this envelope goes straight to our deacon fund. And it's what we use to help people who are in need, whether they need a place to stay, whatever it is. So in case you were wondering, and if you hadn't had an opportunity to ever give, it's not too late. You can still give. You can take it home, decide what you want to give, and bring it back and drop it in the office. But I just want to make sure you understood that every dime from this goes straight to helping other people and whatever it is they need. We've helped people with apartments. We've helped people with cars. We've helped people with simple things, big things, and in-between things. And it's always only possible because of your generosity. You're a generous church. You really are. So that's what this is, and I wanted to tell you thank you for giving. So as we get ready to sing, what are we going to sing? Oh, oh, come to the altar. So go ahead and stand as we sing. Sing a, oh, come to the altar.
Is calling.
So, Father, may we turn to you. May we look at you. May we find you, God. And, Father, may you encourage us. May we see your love in everything, in every part of our life. Father, I pray for each and every person as they leave today, including myself and my family. Keep us safe. Take care of those things we need help with, God. Answer the prayers that we need. In your timing and in your way. And Lord, if there's something in our lives that we're asking for that's not exactly what you want, God, may you show us. Minister to us all today in this day and every day as we leave, for it's Jesus' precious and holy and healing name I pray, and we all say. Amen. Thank you, everyone.